In this lecture, we will introduce the fields of big data in data science and the associated concepts. First of all, why should we talk about big data? Let's start with a bit of history. Back in the 80s, computers helped in collecting data, but they were analyzed using methods that dated back to the 19th century. However, in the late 90s, data started to accumulate at a faster pace. We witnessed a widening gap between the data availability and our capability of analyzing it. This prevented us from benefiting from the big data that we were able to collect. Only with modern big data analysis and storage techniques, and with machine learning and data science, we can try to speed up our implementation and therefore increase our analytical capability. Thanks to big data technologies and data science methods, the gap between data availability and analytical capability is closing. We are becoming able to take decisions at a speed and with an accuracy previously unseen. But how can we define the concept of big data? It's widely accepted that big data can be defined according to four characteristics, all starting with V. We then talk about the four V's of big data. The very first dimension, or first V, of big data is volume. Terabytes, petabytes, and even exabytes of data accumulated on cheaper and cheaper storage solutions. This dimension is also known as data at scale. But big data is not just characterized by volume. The fact that data is shared and stored in many forms is called variety. This dimension refers to the ever-growing amount of data formats and shapes. This data is frequently stored outside the traditional structured databases. Text, images, videos, and more generally, any information format stored and consumed in multimedia systems such as the web. Another big data dimension is velocity, or data in motion. By velocity, we mean that data is not a static concept. It is continuously produced, transmitted, and consumed. Therefore, we need to implement the ability to analyze streams of data, continuously recorded and received, to enable decisions within fractions of second. Last but not least, big data is characterized by veracity. In this case, the challenge to address is data uncertainty. We need techniques that are able to manage the reliability and predictability of inherently imprecise or plainly wrong data. Indeed, experience shows that most data sources are noisy, partly unreliable, or even deceiving. Unfortunately, the only certainty about uncertainty is that it's not likely to go away without specific and tailored interventions. In summary, these are the so-called four V's of big data: volume, variety, velocity, and veracity. Some additional interpretations have extended this set with other V's: value, volatility, validity, and so on. Now that we have learned what big data is, let's focus on how we can manage it. We enter the field of data science. But what is data science? We can define it as the science and art of discovering what we don't know from the data. Differently from traditional statistics and the scientific method, we do not need to formulate hypotheses in advance to be tested. Thanks to data science, we can obtain predictive, actionable insight from data and thus create data products that have business impact. Being so innovative, data science also requires the ability to communicate relevant business stories from the data and to build confidence in decisions that drive business value. This means defining self-explanatory data analysis. People don't want only results, they want results and the motivation that led to them. To this end, a data scientist must be polyglot As a traditional researcher, he must have deep knowledge in mathematics and statistics, as well as substantive expertise in a given industry or domain for appropriately applying the methods. On the other hand, he must also master computer science, and in particular machine learning methods. Indeed, there are two cultures in statistical modeling that data scientists must master. On the one hand, a data scientist must understand the traditional modeling approaches. These include statistical analysis methods that feed data on well-known functions, such as linear and logistic regression. On the other hand, a data scientist must also know methods from machine learning, such as decision trees and neural networks. In these methods, the function that transforms the independent variable x in the response variable y is unknown in advance. But still, after a training phase, the methods become able to accurately predict y given the value of x. Once the tools from those two cultures are acquired, the data scientist can try to describe and predict any aspects of the world, according to the data that partially describe them based on a limited set of features. Data can allow us to take better decisions, which will result in implementing better actions. Descriptive analytics can help a decision maker to interpret and understand the reality. Based on that, he will take more informed decisions. Predictive analytics instead tells a human what will happen or what is likely to happen, thus making it easier to take strategic decisions on future directions to take. Gartner, the well-known advisory and strategic consultancy company, introduced two additional types of analytics: diagnostic analysis, which tells why something happened, and prescriptive analysis, which reduces to a minimum or even eliminates the need of the human in the loop in the decision-making processing, by directly providing prescriptions on how to act based on the analysis of the data. A question may arise about what we are trying to solve here. More precisely, when we have an analysis to run over the data, why shouldn't we just ask a software developer to write a specific program to solve it? Indeed, when you have a problem and you want to solve it, you have two options. Programming, where you can ask a programmer to understand the problem and write a specific software code. Or you hope that a machine can automatically learn from the data and find appropriate solutions. We consider this as a generic machine learning procedure and declare the problem in a way that the solution can be found following such a generic procedure. For simple and well-codified problems, programming is often the most effective and efficient approach. But when the problem becomes complex, implies blurred or flexible problem settings, or involves very complex data structure, the machine learning way may become the only viable option.